Hello, hello. Oh my God, I'm 1 minute early and there's already two of you. Not a bad thing. How are you, Leon? Haven't seen you in a while. I know one thing, you are muted.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I'm fine. I got back from a holiday and I'm getting back up to speed.
Good, good. How was your holiday?
Yeah, it was great. We visited a lot of cities in Germany and Austria and Czech Republic. So yeah, it was really nice.
Oh, excellent. I think there's
And how
something
was
strange.
it?
Sorry, no, sorry, there was something strange with my audio, but I fixed it. Yeah, what were you saying?
Oh. Yeah, and how was it here?
Yeah, it was good. The weather's been on and off, and most important thing in my world is that this morning, for the first time ever, my son managed to open the outside door by himself.
Oh,
Literally a milestone of I can open the door. I was like, okay, great. So that was amazing.
wow. Nice.
How about you, Mark? How's your summer been so far?
Oh, fine. Yeah, I've just been away up north visiting family, so just got back sort of yesterday evening. But I'm busy in preps for hypertext and finishing up on that and the sort of final couple of months of the project, academic project I'm working on data.
Cool. I had a bit of a stress earlier today. That I think we all need to discuss. It's about AI. What I did was I found a Mac app called PDF Pals, and it actually does a whole PDF. It doesn't have a limitation with how many characters and all of that stuff, tokens and so on. So I guess they have a nice stitching mechanism built in. And so I ran it through some of the PDFs I have with our work, and it's staggeringly good at doing summaries and keywords and key phrases and stuff. This is something Mark and I have been talking about for a while. So I wrote this little thing that I've put in the chat for us. I think that well, hopefully a few more will join us today, but I hope that as a community we should probably decide that one of the key topics for our next book and symposium needs to be AI. Completely ignoring the dangers, not because they're not horrible, they are, but other people are dealing with them. But only focusing on who do we want to be with AI? What kind of person? That has to be first, and then kind of look back from that. We don't want, I mean, of course, we want AI to do the boring stuff, but we don't want it to do our thinking. So how can we, what is that balance? It's obviously tricky, but also important because last Friday, I was with a group of dads an evening through someone, anyway. And he, from one of the major universities in the UK, I learned that they use now AI to sort applications from students. They get so many applications for these high-powered programs, and the applications are about 30 pages at least. So for decades, they've used human people to summarize and put things in spreadsheets so the people who need to make the decisions have it available. It turns out the AI summary and organizing is better, meaning less errors, because humans make errors. And that's just the reality. And they have seen now that the majority of applications coming in are written by AI on behalf of students. You know, it's
How
the
do you
same.
validate that?
It's just their feeling that it
So
once
it's not, in other words, it's not, it's just, it feels good. So I see it's less effort and it's done and you get a spreadsheet faster. But I am genuinely interested in because a
no,
gut
which one?
feeling
Validate
isn't enough
it.
to rest on.
Are you talking about validating the organizing or
Yeah,
validating?
so if people are saying it does it better, I mean, we seem to be in a loop at the moment where, as you've just said, so people are using effectively some kind of scripting device,
No, but
which
hang on,
may be
Mark.
some
I
flavor
just
of
want to.
AI.
I
Well,
want
hold
to
on a
make.
second.
I'm talking about two different things. I just want to understand what you mean, so I don't misunderstand you. Are you talking about using AI for the the analysis of the applications, or are you talking about the students using AI to write the applications?
Well, both, because they're interconnected, because it's sort of kind of garbage in, garbage out loop. If I
Yeah.
mean, what people are doing is they're, I mean, arguably the problem is that the overall form is not fit for purpose. Because if somebody has to use a machine to basically fill out the form that asks for too much information they don't really understand, and then someone on the other end has to take a machine to unpack that, the issue is, I mean, there are two things there. So one is they have a serious problem and they need to actually think through their process. But the
Mark.
other part is that and it's a perfectly serious question, is how are they actually validating it? Because people tend to say, oh, it's much better. And then when you ask, it's sort of, well, it feels right. And I don't doubt that's true, but I'm just surprised that they're not testing a bit more deeply, because otherwise
Okay,
people understand.
I can answer that. First of all, it's not a couple of forms to hang on, I'll just wait for Mr. Peter to join us. Hey,
Good
Peter.
morning. I'm
Hey.
brunching with mom, so I have the camera off so you don't see me eating.
Okay, sounds good. We're just talking about how universities now have started using AI to process applications. So, Mark, to address your question, not necessarily answer it, but from what I learned on Friday, is that first of all, it's not just a matter of filling in forms. A lot of it is people's recommendations, extracurricular, their essays, all these things. There are a myriad of things because this is for advanced degrees. It's not just doing a transcript, but it also is things like translating different countries' grades into UK standards. There's a lot of things like that. And they have found that the error rate, and this is someone's been doing it for many, many years, the error rate he found when dealing with humans compared to dealing with AI, where he is the one in charge of building the AI models, is less. So what the exact numbers are, I don't know, but what we're talking about, not misinterpreting saying this guy is better than this other guy, but it's quite literally it's in the wrong part of the Excel spreadsheet.
Right. And so, yeah. And so, how much of that is actually AI, and how much of that is basically just clever algorithmic extraction, which is not sort of AI as such? So in other words, it sounds as though someone's done a much better extraction and translation schema. Well, it's just the term AI gets used really
It
loosely.
is a loose term. But the reality of it today, it is a loose term.
But I don't think we should be. It doesn't help us to be as loose in our understanding of it. Otherwise, we're contributing to the problem
Okay,
as opposed to actually
I
becoming
can't.
useful.
They use ChatGPT. So it's AI. The
Right. How do they
discussion.
do the provenance stack? So if you wanted to question.
Mark, I don't know, okay? And look, I know you're a hugely critical person when it comes to AI, but all I'm stating in the beginning of this discussion today is the fact that a major university has found AI to be better at processing this. Of course, there are issues, right? All I'm saying is that students are also now been shown to use it for their applications. Students will be using AI to write papers, no matter what teachers and schools and universities say. So, and this is literally my 1 minute intro. So, I think it is useful for our community to look at how do we want that to be? Accepting that it exists, how do we want it to be? And it's actually an incredibly hard question because, as you and I discussed last week, for instance, doing something as simple as helping the library and software like I'm doing in Reader, what for? Is it to help you find connections? Is it help you to learn? Is it to cut down on your workload? The what for question that you asked is really, really important. Peter.
Yeah, I rather think that if I was a college admissions person, I'd be looking at an organization like Kaplan, say, and have them get my candidates to come in to a physical room in the real world where they'd have to answer some questions by themselves without using any tech, so that I can see that it definitely is 100% their writing, as opposed to ChatGPT combing the very best admissions essays, merging them together, and generating an essay which gives me absolutely zero indication of whether the student can think for himself or not.
Okay, but that's not possible because the particular university and degree I'm talking about, it's 2,000 applications at 30 pages each, at a ratio of something between 5 or 7 to 1 admissions, you know, to even get closer down the line. So of course, you know, having the human interaction is better.
Well, then maybe a first pass by AI and then force them in a situation where they can't be.
Okay, Peter. Peter, I'm not going to. I'm sorry, Brandel, just briefly. We're talking. I just put into the chat here something. I'm just going to really. Provenance for what? Okay.
Well, okay. Will you allow me to explain? Because
sure.
No, I get what you're saying, but don't. And there's no need to be defensive because I'm not arguing against what you're saying. What I'm reflecting is that there's a massive interest in AI, especially in a situation where if it makes my job seemingly easier, I have less work to do. It's good. If it in some way works against me, it's bad, which is not unhelpful and simplistic. One of the issues, though, is when one makes a flat statement like, okay, I fed it onto ChatGPT and I got an answer out that was better. Then my point about provenance is, okay, if I want to then go into that and say, right, you know, why do these ones float to the top of the stack?
Okay, Mark,
that's you know, I need to be able to do that.
Yes, I understand that. And that, okay, so Randall, the discussion we just started is based on last Friday, I spent an evening with a couple of other dads. One of them used to run admissions for one of the big universities in this country for one of the very advanced degrees. The admissions are roughly 30 pages of various documentation, essays and everything per student. They get something like 2,000 student applications. They used to have humans do the basic analysis and spreadsheeting and all that stuff. They now use AI because in their view, it does a better job, meaning less errors. I also learned that already now, these applications are generally written by AI as well. So it's kind of an arms race, and it's something we know. It was just a PDF PALS, Mark. PALS, PALS. So the reason I'm saying this is I downloaded this app, PDF PALS, that I just mentioned out to Mark as well. And what it allows me to do is analyze through my own GPT key an entire PDF rather than a section. So of course they have a clever way of chunking and all of that stuff. And this today then made me really quite stressed because I feel the summarization in AI is absolutely phenomenal. You know, having gone through many of our articles and so on, I feel that it really gets the gist. I also feel that PDFs, academic ones, are often quite hard to read. There is that specific language, there is the thin columns, all these issues. Anyway, so I got very stressed earlier today about the issue of, hang on, my screen's acting up. What's going on here? One second. No, apologies, everyone. There we go, right. So I put a link in here, I think, what we should do as a community is write a few prompts, joke on purpose, to our community to invite people to write for the new volume and also to invite further people. Let's say that we accept there are many issues with AI and we ignore them because others are addressing them. But what we want to do is try to imagine who we would like to be with AI. You know, do we want it to have like a person to speak to, or do we want a sculpture, that kind of stuff? I really think it's useful for us to go down that line and start asking these kinds of questions. You know, because clearly the children will be using AI. How do I want Edgar's brain to be involved in an AI augmented system? Over.
My issue is that I still don't see why I am not like entitled to reject the entire premise of AI. I don't think it's real, and I don't think that the projection of AI as a phenomenon helps us a great deal. Like I don't know if I linked or if anybody saw the article about how the term AI was coined in the first place to avoid having to relate one a person or people's movement to Norbert Wiener and cybernetics. I'm much more comfortable with the cybernetics sort of like landscape framework and implications for what this kind of work is. Because like most of the things that people call generative AI right now are linear regression models and things like that, that people use. So when you were talking about the admissions, a friend of mine used to work in New Zealand immigration intelligence. And he said that the, hey, Alan, sorry, we were talking about AI again. It comes up. So in the, and essentially like the top 20% and the bottom 20% of immigration applicants are kind of admitted through a largely automated screening. I don't know that he called it AI at the time we were having these conversations, but it's the sort of thing that would be captured in it. And it works because the context of the applications is so straightforward. Like if you give the same set of documents to the people based on sort of internal audits and reviews, then they will come up with the same decisions because they have really high confidence signals that are pointing to this is a person we should accept, this is a person we should reject. I find the sort of the nature of the discourse once people use these automated toolings and term them to be AI so much more fraught that I don't know what I get out of it.
All right. So one thing that I find really boring is discussing what AI is. It's a worthwhile topic for a specific community, but I think at this point, I honestly think we just have to accept that there is such a thing that people in general call AI, whether it's strong AI or it's just an algorithm here. All these things are important, of course. But when someone sits down to work, there will be tools with this label available to them, right? And they can be, like my professor and friend also of Mark, Les, says it shouldn't be called artificial intelligence, it should be called advanced IT, because it's such a huge collection of things. Absolutely agree with that. But what I do think we need to do, in the same way that we have and need to continue to embrace rich environments, AR, VR, projectors, all that stuff, which is so crucial. I really think that we need to wrap our brains around who do we want to be when we use this? I don't think our community wants it to do the thinking for us. And when Mark talked about provenance earlier, yes, I don't think right now AI is good at giving answers, but it's really good at doing a kind of analysis. But there needs to be a lot of prompt engineering. I was just reading up on it today, like, if you ask it to do something, it's actually useful to go back and check itself. There are all these things that if we can maybe look at, you know, in an ideal, let's say we have proper research money just to build somebody's office for student or professional, how would we want to interact with it? What would we like it to be? I think these are worthwhile questions.
So I agree with that. I would also say, though, that we've been through a couple of movements and fads that have taken up a lot of oxygen and money in the form of things like cryptocurrency, Web3 for whatever that is, the NFTs and all of that stuff. And there are times when it can be challenging to say, like, what happens when we reject the entire premise of this and say that no aspect of this is correctly framed for us to be able to get a benefit out of it? And I feel like the scale of fraud that is accompanying AI right now is sort of means that we need to be able to kind of reserve that right and say, what if everybody is either wrong or lying about this? So, yeah.
I don't mind that as a specific discussion along the lines, a lot of similar things, but I do think it's time to, in the same way, I don't know if some of you saw it, I posted on Twitter this, the huge computer 50 years ago going into a building, and now someone holding up a tiny little chip saying it's the same thing. And, you know, in the same way that we have accepted that the headset style stuff is going to be real soon. The AI stuff, I really think we need to, let's call it Amber or Azure, you know, let's give it a whatever name. But that thingamajig, because first of all, for summaries and analysis now, it's absolutely brilliant. I think it is better than human. You know, I've been going through a lot. Mark helped me last week go through a few things of in Reader. If I build in an AI thing, just open a ChatGPT just to help do summaries of the articles, how best to present it. You know, these are important issues because, goodness gracious, it's actually very good. But beyond that, beyond just having more text from text, how much, you know, where can we go? There are things we also discussed where extract keywords in this corpus and only show me documents where, only show the keywords where at least two of the documents have. But why? Is that to see connections? You know, to it's easy to moan about AI. I do it too. But when we moan to someone, they have every right to say, well, what do you want? So that's what I'm hoping we can do. We can talk a little bit about, this is what I want. If I have control of AI's interactions, this is what I want. I'm wondering if today, if you look at the list that I sent, maybe we could think of some further questions and send it to the community at the end of the call. Leon, please go ahead.
Yeah. I'm not sure if this is the right comparison, but could we compare this to something else? Like, let's say if somebody told you like, hey, I'm really impressed by these self-driving cars. I will get rid of all my employees. I will just use these self-driving cars. The error rate is much lower. And like, I'm curious, this is a question back to you. Like, if somebody says something like that, would you imagine like, no, I don't want people to be like that? Would you not like your child to say these kind of things later, like, oh, and have be enthusiastic about getting rid of people? Is that what the stress partially is, perhaps?
I have a self-driving car. So I drive a 2016 Tesla. I bought it new back in the day, still have it, doesn't have the updated tech. And I think it's a great analogy for many reasons. First of all, when I drive down to Southampton, at stretches on the motorway, I use it to check my email, things like this. I can spend a minute or two feeling quite safe doing that. Do I believe that Elon Musk's promise that by the end of the year that he said 5 years in a row, it will be completely? No. So that's half of it. The other half of the question is, do I want to get rid of people? Absolutely not. But you know, I'm going through my corrections now, and I'm not saying that my software and what we're doing should all be about someone doing a master's or a PhD, but it's absolutely insane how many documents I have read that have to regurgitate the history of hypertext just to prove that they know what it is, right? That there is a lot of filler out there. And in order to connect these things, to look at these things, I want to include the human brain. I think that is very, very important. But the human brain is a finite thing, finite resource. So getting rid of crud and defining what crud is, of course, is hugely problematic. No question. No one needs to bring that up. I completely agree. But there is just an acceptance that, you know, I'm a father. I'm scared. There's a lot of crap that's happening in the world at the moment. There is a lot. And AI is one of them. So I'm not saying let's just pile on the AI and everything will be fine. I'm absolutely not saying that. So many issues with taking up work, doing creative stuff, absolutely no question. But I really think that the issue of, well, what do you want then? Considering AI is happening, it is real in some form, considering in some forces it excels, some places it excels, other places it's actually devious. I think we need to decide how we want it. And I think it will feed also into our VR type work. You know, as Doug Engelbart said, dreaming is hard work. You know, the more I look at coding for the Vision Pro, the more I do different things, the more I see, like we discussed last time here, space management is absolute hell because you have more opportunity. You know, AI is problematic because it happens in a black box and it's almost infinite in a sense. But, you know, what do we want? I see what you're right here, Mark. I completely agree, but what is filler and papers is contextual and varies depending on expertise and point of view. Oh, absolutely. But the thing is, I think my thesis would be much better if I say, for the history of hypertext, refer to Mark's paper, page so-and-so.
Sure, and I understand that. I mean, I really, what it says to me is that the issue about stuff, you know, things like there being sort of too much boilerplate or filler, is that that's our lack of attention to the, basically the framework of our writing. But that's a sort of community matter to decide. I mean, one of the things that I'm genuinely interested by, I mean, because I don't mean to sound sort of particularly doubting of AI as such. I mean, I think it's tremendously useful. I find most of the things that are put in front of me and told are good turn out to be someone saying, hey, I don't have to do this anymore. But without any, you know, without any quality control applied to that, because look, I press a button or I speak to this thing and I get an answer back. I totally see that in a lot of basically bounded problems, especially ones that are basically set in more graphical than textual, machine learning AI is doing very good stuff. You know, some of the medical diagnosis stuff, and in a sense, why wouldn't it? There's kind of scary thing there is we still don't know quite how it does it, because it can't tell us why it thinks this one is a good and this one is a bad. And that's something that that's far more important to concentrate on than the sort of the general part of it, because we want to have trust. We want to have trust in these things. Otherwise, we really do lose control and it becomes a magic eight ball.
Mark, I agree with that. Well, I agree with half of it. First of all, when AI finds a solution and statistically it's better than something else, like cancer detection, as it has been used for, a human operator often also couldn't tell why. You know, it's almost instinct. Let's call it machine instinct, right?
I don't think that's true. Is there evidence to support that?
Okay, here's the thing. When it comes to, I simply don't want to spend any time on discussing the negatives of AI because there are so many forums for it. You know, asking a question of AI, ask AI if Doug and I have been working together, it'll tell you the truth this much and then it'll make up crap here, right? I agree with that, 100%.
Right. But don't cast it. It's not a negative, good, bad thing. I think you're misunderstanding.
But there are specific things it is very good at. If I ask it to summarize a document, that is something that it does, I think, really well, better than most humans can do.
Yeah, but I the danger is I don't see it in a sort of binary zero sum game of it's all good or it's bad. The point of raising some of the things that I'm talking about is it's a conduit to understanding to get to the question of what you're asking of how do we want to relate with it? Because if we don't really understand how it works, is it just like joining a new religion where the guy in the big robe tells you what to do?
No, it's not. When you talked, you know, we have an amazing group of people here. Let's take Brandel, for instance, right? With his position and his experience, when we ask Brendel a question about VR, I don't know how his brain works, but I have established trust, right? And to re-emphasize, asking questions of AI at this point, I think is highly problematic for that reason. But to ask AI to help with analysis, not just give us an A-B answer, but to help us, because one of the key things that's on the OpenAI website, it says, do not trust it. Ask it to check its own work, you know, look at the different data, take it into Excel. And that's what I'm really talking about. What kind of co-pilot, so to speak, do we want ideally AI to be? I mean, I started framing VR as being a thinking cap. That's kind of my joking term for it now. That's how Ismail and Vint are presenting. It's a thinking cap. You don't use it all the time. Same with AI. The stuff it does well, how do we want it? And it's really, really hard because even the summary thing, where should we best present it? Even if we accept it works. Should you get the summary when you read the document? Should it be for a corpus? Sorry, Leon, please go on.
Yeah, I think actually we should, it would be great to use it as a as our personal Mark Anderson, because for example, Mark was just trying to clarify the question and not immediately accepting the question. And I think it would be great to sort of have a minimum requirement as a person to AI that you want your question to be questioned in the first place, in order to get maybe to let's say an intermediate answer. Or but I think that is a bit what I find a bit annoying about this ChatGPT kind of solutions is that people use it and they can ask a stupid question and they get an answer and they think it's great and wow, it's fantastic. But I think that is a very, as Mark Anderson said, a very garbage in, garbage out. And I would really like to be a person in the future which is enthusiastic about a certain a minimum standard of AI input-output between my brain and this AI machine, where it doesn't give you these, these sort of direct answers, which are most of the time a bit silly.
This is exactly what I wanted to discuss, Leon, and I'll give the mic over to Alan in a second. One of the things I thought about while walking today, being very frustrated, was when you have it analyzed, let's say an academic PDF, don't just do a summary, but do other things like, are there any clear logical fallacies in here? Are there contradictions? You know, basically, you know, click button, but you have a few. You can choose what to apply, you can pre-make that. So when you open something up, it's got a bit of basic analysis ready for you. Similarly, when you author work, it would be really useful if you get all the same analysis on the exit, on the export. You can see, okay, this is how AI sees my work. It is wrong, fine, export. But it was, oh no, these are actual issues. Let me go back. So yes, the conversational mode in this sense is really interesting to discuss. Thank you, Leon. Alan.
Yes. So Leon, I like that point as well, because it's a focus less on the AI and its capabilities today, which, you know, it's a very open horizon, right? Like there may be hard limits with hallucination, or that may be solved tomorrow, right? But instead focusing on what we can't control, right? Which is like how to create better prompts. Or one of the things I was thinking about yesterday after reading about Azure's private enterprise LLM offering, which is pretty exciting for enterprise documentation, and also realizing that it will most likely fail for reasons that it could do its job perfectly well, right? Like suck in all the documents from an enterprise and have intelligent answers and still fail, because there are impediments built into the enterprise, like permission layers or the volatility of some kinds of knowledge over others, that it will cease to, it could do its job perfectly and still not be a sufficient job. So what needs to be looked at are, you know, what are the opportunities in the interface in the virtuous cycle between man and machine? What can be built into, like in that toy example of an enterprise LLM, because it's inherently like sort of discontinuously collaborative with other people in the enterprise, you know, would that be a good place for you ask a question, you get an answer and it's sourced somewhere. But if you go to the source, you could see that like Mark asked a totally unrelated question, but it touched on this bit of found material. Would you like to see what Mark was asking, right? And a kind of to put a pin on it, the interesting problem with prompting is that there are so many problems that we don't know how to frame yet. We don't know how to phrase. We don't know what we're asking for. And in that light, like actually going through a corporate Slack, the historical knowledge there, could be more useful than talking to a GPT version, because you could see people talking about things that you don't even know how to frame the question, and then it reminds you, right? In the current paradigm, there's not really an interface for that sort of synoptic view or discovery. I think there's a lot of interesting opportunities with that, which gets onto another topic, but I'll hold that for later.
Brandel.
So I think another issue that I have with LLMs at this point, similar to what Alan was saying, is that the feedback loops, the cycles of work, and how it's done are like just vastly too large. In a context of work with new untrusted people, you know, I have tended to give them very small jobs and have the ability to supervise their work on a moment-to-moment basis and give them momentary sort of corrections as I sort of understand what it is they seem to be trying to do in order to make sure that I can elevate and improve the sort of the working process that they have. That's when I'm asking other people to do work. When other people are working with me, then I'm asking for even smaller chunks of work. The problem with generative AI of all forms, I've actually gotten back into drawing and painting. I like made a Minecraft character for my daughter, which was very fun. Is that when I draw or paint, I don't want AI to make a picture for me. I barely want AI to control, to take the pen, to be able to handle a particular contour or fill in a shape. That the absolute joy of creation, and not everybody is creating with a level of volume that means that they're permitted to take joy in every single stroke. But I get a lot out of those things. And if somebody were to just make another picture like mine, then that's a total cross purpose as to what I'm doing. I don't think that's an intractable problem for AI, in the sense that it would be possible for people to build generative tools or build assistive tools where there were where the learning models are right down into the details of every single pen stroke, every character, every rewording, and all of those things. But it's a Until I have AI tools that are trained on the process, yeah, like you say, Frodo, like the process versus the result. I think I'm basically not. I haven't seen anything that an AI can do for me that I'm personally interested in. When they have just these massive sort of turns where they'll go away and write an entire paragraph about something that. I don't have those moment-to-moment abilities to apply course correction to. And I also don't have really the ability to think about how I can earnestly incorporate the output of that into a technical workflow in the sense of, you know, like I was writing a video game with my daughter, and what I do there is I say, okay, so now the ball is dropping. Now let's make it so that the ball drops faster every moment by creating momentum or acceleration. And now let's put a shadow under it and let's make a little bounce sound and all of those bits and pieces. I don't know how I can write a program and have AI help like that, or write a program where AI helps in the program like that. So yeah, and those are not impossible problems, but they are not they're manifestly problems that are not being solved by the current core crop of discourse.
Right, but Brandel, you of all people, you use a lot of AI every day, right?
I don't use speech recognition. I hate it. It's garbage.
Have you ever taken a picture with your iPhone?
Yeah, I don't love the corrections that applies there either. I used to have a SLR, and I like the output better.
Oh, I completely agree with you. I'm exactly the same, but there's a couple of things. First of all, you're an extremely bright person. You know, you do things differently. I'm just saying that the students are going to be using AI, no matter what we think, right? They're going to use it, and they're going to use it either to cheat or to augment their brains, or both. It's just going to happen. I don't think we have any say of that at all. But all I'm saying is that for the available stuff, some of it we should just tell them to run away from. Other stuff, we can say, here's a bit better way of doing it and do better tooling. I mean, one thing I'll show you here briefly. So this is the library and Reader right now. And all I've done is, this is completely fake in terms of layout just here. This section of these paragraphs, that is a summary of one of the documents, not this one, because I'm playing with different ways. It's really pretty brilliant, right? And if you then go and open these documents, you know, it's readable, but, you know, but there's a lot of stuff, unless you really know that you want to, unless you really know you want to read it, why not have the, why not use this kind of a summary to help you determine that, right? That's probably useful to help you get to that stage. But what about the further stages of getting it in here?
It is interesting, because while you're talking, I mean, it's interesting that Peter put up, you know, obviously a prompt back from something, and by paragraph three, it had made up two papers. And that shows actually just how, in a sense, how powerful the system is. It's getting it wrong, and I don't see that error as it being sort of evil as such. It's sort of doing what it's designed to do. It does show that perhaps people designing it aren't applying as much thought as they should to all parts of it. You know, I guess it's the sexy part is the algorithmic code at the heart, and the rest of it's a bit of an add-on, because that's often the way software rolls. But it's actually very pertinent, because I think this thing of summary is sort of quite interesting. And I think what I hear reflected back to me is very much things either speak to somebody or they don't. And it's actually quite personal, and it's not a right or wrong. I don't see it as a sort of a binary thing. And it's actually quite contextual. If it's choosing the best taxi rank or the best sushi house to go to, probably no big deal. Something perhaps closer to which surgeon might do surgery, say, on your back or your heart or something, I probably might, you know, not be so ready to just take a supposed AI solution. And that's a problematic thing at the moment. It's a very immature thing. And the struggle for us societally is that it's also very beguiling. It gives you an answer.
Okay. Mark, sorry for interrupting you, but we know it gives rubbish answers. That is one of the knowns. I don't think AI is good to, unless you're asking like a basic physics or nature thing that you can then check. It does that. I'm not advocating.
Okay, so here's, right. So hold on to that statement and apply it to the fact that something does good summaries. Those two things cannot both be true.
Yes, of course they can.
Well, not if it's making stuff up.
No, but Mark, just, okay, have you tried it? Okay, tell you what, let's try it together, because what I'm going to do is open up a Mark Anderson paper and do a summary.
You can take my current paper and summarize it. I mean, the thing is, it's really difficult. The trouble is, I'm not being absolutist about it, but I have a genuine interest. I mean, I want these things to work. I like them to get better. But part of the making them better is to understand the way in which they fail. It's the way we train as humans. We learn by the errors we make. Because often we don't understand why we're making them, and our reflection on the errors we make teaches us ways to avoid that, either because we have a better understanding of the subject or at the most rubric level, that we know things to avoid doing. And I'm sorry if I use the word make stuff up, because I'm not trying to put a sort of moral edge into it or something.
Right. Okay.
But at the end of the day, it comes down to trust.
You can read the text, right?
Yeah, I just hold on a second. I just need to move a message out of the way. No, I'm not. That doesn't really seem to, if I'm honest, as I wrote the paper.
It discusses the evolution and usage of hypertext systems.
Yes, well, that's it doesn't criticize the proliferation of commercial digital formats. I mean, is it an immediate linear sentence too? No, I mean, I would tell the person that wrote the summary to go and read the paper. The difficult thing is that we seem to be sucked into a sort of zero-sum argument, and that's not really what I'm interested in here. I am sort of interested in how we move to a point where I have greater trust. I mean, I think this stuff is really impressive, super cool. I'd just like it to be more accurate. And part of that probably is to have some sense of provenance built into it, for it to acquire the ability to understand how it comes, rather than rolling the magic eight ball on co-occurrence of words.
Okay, so I asked it to do something else. I asked about the key points. The provenance is your paper. But number two is pretty good.
Yeah, but I mean, I think even a child would get that out of the paper, so I'm not that...
That is the whole point. Even a child would get out of the paper if it's read the paper, right? So you can't go from one side saying it's wrong to saying it's correct.
Well, no, the title is called Seven Hypertexts. I mean, I'm just saying there's nothing particularly profound in it finding that. So it's good that he didn't get it wrong.
No, hang on a second. The only place where you say what the seven hypertexts are in a list is really here, right? And it's written in plain language. It's not.
It's written in several places in there.
Yes, but you don't.
Sorry, forgive me. I wrote the paper. I mean, I didn't. Yeah, genuinely yeah, it,
yes.
Oh, it, odd. Wait, hang on.
But okay, so you think right, that this one is
hi,
wrong?
Nice to meet you.
It's what not. Happened? It's not. No, I don't use the word right. wrong. This isn't a zero-sum argument. What I'm saying
is
the first one I didn't find right, to be sort of useful or convincing. The second one I didn't finish reading. It certainly seemed more useful. Was it the good pricey of it? I'm unsure. I mean, but then again, these papers are broadly written in the first instance for people who have some understanding in the field. That I mean, you know, you wouldn't take a paper like that and just give it to a person on the top of the Clapham omnibus and expect them to necessarily understand or engage with it. You might write a sort of abstracted or
okay. The discussion is going in really weird areas, because what I was hoping we would do is try to say AI is a thing. How can we use it? Right? What's good and what's not good? If it suddenly is too easily readable versus it isn't, you know, it's just like to get a little bit beyond that discussion. Anyway, Leon, please.
Yeah, when I was looking at this summary, I was thinking it would be funny if it would basically already sort of predict what was about to happen, that it would say the author does not agree with this summary, and then somehow it would be great if somehow there would be some kind of validation going on with the author that, for example, the later this summary could get a sort of like a check box or something. Yeah, this is agreeable or agreed by the author. I don't know how that would work. How Mark would get this. Summary and validate it, but that would be interesting if you would have like more validation on whatever is being summarized of an article which has been written by a person of whom's metadata is already in the document, and maybe with some contact info, some kind of validation channel in the document. But yeah. That was just a random thought.
No, it's not random at all. It's very. This is something that, believe it or not, Mark and I actually talked about last week. Here, it says AI generated, but if the user goes in and edits it, it's no longer saying AI generated. So to say to have what you're saying, that a validation or it no longer just AI but assisted. These things are really important part of the discussion for sure. Yes, Mark.
I mean, I do, out of interest, because if I, listening to Leon's last point. In fact, I, David, my co-author, actually, I know did some summarization using, I guess, ChatGPT or something similar while we were authoring, because, and this is why I made the point in the chat at the side about human in the loop. I think it's useful, because I think it does. There are two really useful things it can do. It can tell you, it can do a first pass of, does what you write come across sort of correctly? And that can be useful. In other words, actually, are you writing about what you thought you are? And in a more directed sense, it can be useful for helping us with the fact that increasingly some of the primary readers of what we write will not be human. So another tailback is a slightly different one, is what does a computer think, or what does an AI, use that term, what does an AI read into it? And that's actually quite important, because in a sense, if there's a disconnect there, then that's the beginning of your garbage in, garbage out cycle, because these things feed on themselves.
Yeah.
Unintentionally, but in essence, they do. So being able to, there's a really useful thing, and I mean, I think one of the things that may come out of it is we may find not in every context in which we write, but in some contexts we may find ourselves needing to write in a slightly different way, or some of us may need to, some may not, in order to make sure that the non-human actors who will interact with effectively the text of what we write will actually get the correct sort of understanding for what we write.
Yes, super important. So you will remember that we have this AI edition of the Future of Text 3 that we're experimenting with, where on the left we have AI summary, on the right we have the first page of the article. And of course you can click to open the original. I think you've all seen that. So that's cool, and it certainly helps. But these books that we're producing together are just absolutely massive. So I do think AI summaries are cool, AI key points are cool, but I think it is really just the beginning. What I want to see is more of Brandel's magic carpets, right? If we can figure out ways to do prompts from either a set of articles in one of our books or in a lot of research articles, which are useful to the reader, and then to be able to present them as more of a landscape. Because one thing Mark discovered, as he's told me, PDF articles from ACM, for instance, have a lot of nonce keywords, meaning keywords only used in that article. Other keywords tend to be more too general. So to generate useful keywords is hard. And it may or may not work with this. So if we, you know, so the whole thing, we want to be able to work in a huge VR kind of space somehow, right? At least part of the time. What the hell do we show? Do we show the keywords up there? Do we show articles? Do we show authors? Do we show connections? These are really difficult issues. And can we use colors and shapes to build this? I mean, I want to have a system whereby, first of all, one thing that's actually a bit difficult with ACM is to download all the PDFs from a conference. It tends to be one each, which is a bit loopy. I'm sure we could do a script. But the point is, imagine if I can engineer with an AI to do the analysis that we're discussing, but to have it every time there's a new paper, go back and do all of them again and see if there's a contradiction or an addition. You know, this is when it becomes interesting. If there is a change, how does it tell me? Just by boring old text? I mean, I'm the Future of Text guy, but I think text can be extremely limited for things like this. You know, imagine if, you know, remember fax paper? It gets yellow when it gets old. Imagine if we have a pile of information where something is burning hot because there are other papers saying this is rubbish now. You know, these are amazing things, but they're only the tip of the iceberg for how we can think with it. Sorry, over, Mark.
Oh, I was just thinking on this thing of sort of keywords. I mean, so there are two ways that this can come in. One is doing sort of, I suppose what you call term extraction. And that can be useful. But again, I think it wants to be done in a way that sort of Ben Schneiderman talks about a lot. It wants to be done human in the loop. So rather, the difficulty, I think, is at the moment that maybe it's just, I don't know what it is culturally, or just your human laziness or something. We get so seduced by getting any sort of an answer, especially one that looks so sort of not artificial, that we rush to, we step past all the other things that we'd normally do in terms of reflection upon it, whether it's stuff we're making ourselves or what we take from others. And yet, I think they can be tremendously useful. I mean, I think term extraction is an interesting one. I mean, the project I'm involved in at the moment, which is sort of starts out from the wonderful thing of saying, can't we get more reuse from the data of our research? You know, in a sense, it's a public good that's being paid for. Why aren't we getting more out of it? But it's really interesting. We sit on the side of the conversation. Everyone's basically saying, why can't I ask Siri to show me all the cool stuff? And yet at the same time, everyone assumes Siri to work out what the cool stuff is because we're too busy to actually describe the work that we do. So you have a sort of closed loop problem. And certainly using some of the AI as certainly when authoring as a sort of as a co-pilot, I think is remarkably useful. But I think just as you need to be trained to learn to fly an aircraft. I mean, you may learn to do it on Microsoft Pilot or whatever, that I don't have a problem with, but you do need to be trained. I don't think many people can just get in an aircraft and not, you know, get up and down without any bad things happen. And I think one of the things we're perhaps overlooking is because it's so easy to get something that looks like an answer, we don't stop to think, okay, how would I best use this? How would I build this in? How would I make this really help me? And I know that you're, in fairness, I know that you're doing it, and the conversations we've had about the way you're putting into Reader, and I which I think are considered and useful.
So you use the term terms, which is really interesting. So if you guys have a look at the screen now, what do you think of this? Does this cover the important terms in your paper, Mark, do you think?
Well, what it's basically done is taken some of the chat. Not really, because it's taken the chapter headings and regurgitated them. And that's the most sort of, that's the simplest form of keywording, but that's a bit like doing it on word frequency. That is not difficult. Where I find it more interesting is when this sort of a system actually comes back with a term that you didn't explicitly state, or it might, you know, using another word, and it sort of can happen. I mean, that's what we want to shade towards. Because one of the problems with the keywords, why they're not useful at the moment in many articles, is people do it at 11:59 just as they're submitting a paper. I'm making a point. They think, this roughly describes what I'm doing. Actually, what we need to be doing when we're creating things like keywords and tags is really what we should be asking is, what term would somebody use to find the thing that I'm writing about? And almost in many cases, it's almost a certainty that it won't be the term that I'd use, or it won't be phrased in the way that I phrase it. And that's one of the areas where I really do see that these systems might help. But it actually requires some testing, because at the moment you can keep typing things into the magic eight ball and you will get an answer out, because it's almost a fundamental requirement that the magic eight ball will give you an answer.
Mark, I completely understand the argument that these things are not flawless. I completely accept that. I'm just wondering in conversation what is more or what is less useful. So, I mean, existentialism is not a heading in the document, but I take your point. But if we just ask it for keywords, that may be the kind of thing, it gave us 22, that if we do that to a whole bunch of documents to see which ones have these in common, might be interesting.
Mm. The interesting thing, for instance, for this, it's also a problem because our search systems are very immature. It's actually really difficult. The sort of keywords that it pulled out there are perfectly valid. They probably wouldn't help you find the thing that you wanted in relation to that paper, those terms alone, because they're effectively subjects. So what Google will give you back is it will give you back the subject. A thing that would be really useful, actually, is if the AI system actually did give you the one of the most useful things it could do is give you the actual reference, because a lot of these things are backed by a sort of a reference that is at least in a peer reviewed sense. People have said, well, this is broadly considered to be the source of this or the general statement that describes it. And that's something that it seems that I do find that the system seems to be bad at, and I don't quite understand why, because they have all that information in their corpus, in their LLM.
Yeah, but if we, sorry, I stopped sharing, but if we do something like this, right, just technically, So we have a look at this. Let's say this is in the system. If I now PKM, okay, I want to know where that's in the document. You know, I can do a search for PKM, and it does show up where it is in the document. You know, and some of it, the things that are keywords tend to be single or double words, but the ones that are longer, of course, is something else.
Yeah. I mean, for the simplest level of learning, yes. But I mean, is that really how you learn on a more complex subject? You actually read the whole thing through, because the terms themselves are only sort of handholds within it, because it's the
this is what I'm hoping we can discuss, right? Mm-hmm. Some of these things work. But what aspect of learning, at what aspect of doing are we addressing?
Yeah. Did you watch Craig Federighi talking about this at WWDC with John Gruber?
No.
Really, really great.
Yeah.
He talks about how at WWDC, Apple made the very conscious decision never to use the term AI, and talked about transformer models in the context there were transformer models, was talking about some of the and machine learning, where it sort of understood machine learning to be a pertinent thing, sort of term for it. I do think that so I also don't think that rejecting the premise of AI per se necessarily means rejecting all of the things that AI, as many people characterize it, do. Like, you know, you said I use AI all the time. And actually, so the photos is a reasonable example in that I liked taking better photos, but I'm definitely the beneficiary of lazier photos that are good enough for every single situation and not having to do white balance and all that kind of stuff. But also a massive place where AI comes in is maps. It's not just you know, A-star or any of these other algorithms, but it's not just because of the cool merch. I don't have a baseball cap I got recently, but that I get from Apple, but that I actually wholeheartedly sort of agree with the approach that it takes, where like AI is able to separate your cute puppy's face from the background to create a sticker and messages. And that's not simply relegating it to the sort of an unimportant task, but to be able to draw a really clear boundary around what it's doing, why it's doing it, and how it kind of integrates with an overall workflow. And I'm a lot more bullish on that as a general sort of approach toward things. You were saying we need more magic carpets, and I was like, gosh, yes, it has been a while. How would I do another one? And what would I get AI to do for me with it? And, you know, one of the first things is you were talking about keyword extraction. I would, if there were any PDFs that didn't have good quality actual ASCII or, you know, Unicode type backing them, I would need to take that through optical character recognition. And, you know, many people would consider that to be AI. If they weren't correctly formatted, or if there are line breaks in a weird place because PDF, then I might attempt to use AI of a kind to be able to do that. And I might even, you know, trust it with assembling some kind of, you know, term frequency and first document frequency thing, or making an assessment of the overall validity of that TF-IDF algorithm over a corpus of documents, in order to be able to say, like, well, I did these ones really well, but once I get back to about 2005 to 1992, then these PDFs are iffy enough that you probably want to take a look at them, because the results don't look good. And I guess I would be comfortable calling a lot of those tasks AI, but I don't know how to do those things with AI, and two, actually, I don't know that enough of the people who use AI and who are sort of boosters for AI are using it in a way that gives me enough of a signal about how to approach it. And given that cliff of utility and information about it, it's almost certainly going to be easier for me to start on my own and build it myself.
Yeah. Leon, please.
Yeah, talking about building myself, I was actually also realizing that we were just looking at this PDF PELS, and we were basically looking at a PDF document, which then through this application triggered server clusters with all these language models, etc., which is sort of bizarre. And I was thinking, taking a step back, it's actually, maybe it also shows a limitation of the author. I think most authors don't have the time to basically add all these questions or answers to questions which students might have to the paper. For example, usually it's a summary or keywords or a very dense or summary. And these are not in those papers, usually in big documents. When it's finished, they will not add all kinds of size summaries to it. But yeah, I was just thinking that in an ideal way, if PDF PELS is sort of a funny concept, it might indicate that the documents in the future should have much more included. And I could even imagine that at some point, while everybody's playing with these things and students, then there is maybe a top five use cases, which they always do. They ask for a summary, they ask for the keywords, and maybe some other things. And I think maybe AI can be used to sort of embed them into the documents so that later you don't need a special application to trigger these language models to do it on the fly. I could imagine something like that. I think now everybody thinks that we will use these language models to summarize things for us, while I think at some point it will be a very cumbersome, boring, clunky way of getting summaries, because maybe we just need better PDFs with all these things inside. Like basically what Frode is doing with the editor, basically showing things and hiding things based on popular demand. So that's an idea.
Putting more stuff in PDFs and on documents in general as a kind of a ground truth, at least ground truth as presented by the source, not that there is an objective truth. Yes, absolutely for that. But the thing is, you know, it's an imperfect tool. Apple Notes improve their PDF capabilities. Needs reader, yes. Reader, yes. It will be fun if we can start just experimenting with what we need. But it's really hard to ask the question, to answer the question, why? Right? The big issue I have in the library, I see your hand. This will be real quick. In the library here, you know, what's the point of, you know, so currently all it does, it has all the highlighted text. Anything you highlight, you can search from the library, which itself is useful. But if we go further and do the thing I just showed you before, include this, why? Is it to stop you reading? Is it to help you decide what to read? Is it to help you see connections? I would really like to have more discussions on that. Mark. You're muted, which
muted. Sorry, your question set me thinking, but the one I was going to mention is that, I mean, I certainly think, I've felt sort of for some while now, that certainly in the sort of scientific, the more empirical end of our communications, that we need to break out of the sort of straitjacket of our old style writing of publishing papers. The paper should just be a report that is built from the data underneath. So in other words, if you don't have the data underneath, you can't write the paper. Whereas at the moment, it's the other way around, and people will tell you, you will ask about something and say, well, it's in the paper, when it isn't. It's in the mind of the person that wrote the paper, it's not in the paper itself. And actually, so building off data, I think that would be much harder to do in some of the humanities, where things are much more conjectural and argumentative, not in the fighty sense, but in you know, the making of an intellectual argument. And I'm not so sure it fits so well there.
Yeah, I mean, to think about like the jump in thinking that came with you know, Playfair and Boyle, around things like the natural sciences and economic people building the, you know, like Edward Tufte's whole shtick of the original sort of data visualizations and things like that. I think that those things are amenable to explicitly quantifiable dimensions in a way that has largely escaped people within software, or yeah, like things that people don't have the same familiarity with measurability and quantification. And I think that there are, and you know, like all models are wrong, some are useful. Like I think it's just that. That computational tools are not sort of immediately within reach of the people who tend to do that kind of social philosophical work in the academic sphere, rather than that it's intrinsically more difficult to capture modes of that contain some value. I mean, maybe that is the same thing. Just that the people who are doing it don't think that way, and it's harder. But yeah, like I think there's a lot that can be done once people have the ability to compose models that have these things, and to have the multimodality of the carpet and other things like that give them a way of being able to kind of easily transpose those things.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm so glad I see Alan's hand coming up, because Brendel, that's really the point. There are so many different users, use cases, and levels to this. And just walking this morning, sorry, Alan, I'll be real quick. I was talking about how to teach maths to Edgar. I don't know that much maths, but there's certain things like fractions and percentages. I just want him to visualize in his head as the key things, because the next thing with maths is a creative medium. You know, what do higher level mathematicians do? They invent stuff. They don't just follow rote things. And that is something that Alan has talked about a lot, you know, the intuitions and getting to that level. So I think what would be really, really good in our community, let's say that maybe next Monday, I'll be traveling, but I should be okay. Anyway, maybe what we try to do is have some discussions on the average student learning something, you know, the average person going through some, you know, fine, that's thing. But what you guys are talking about, what I hope Alan will talk about more now, the whole thing of, I don't know what I'm looking for. I'm here to learn. How can I build things to make that happen? I think would be incredible. Alan, sorry for talking so long.
No problem. This is touches on that. Who's familiar with Hilbert's 23 problems?
Okay. Yeah, come here and embarrass us. Sure, why not? Only Brandel, I'm guessing.
Peter, not a surprise.
Yeah, of course, Peter, yes.
In 1900, David Hilbert, the one person on the planet that von Neumann said was a genius, presented these 23 math problems that were very difficult and not solvable in the traditional sense. There was more about, are these problems provable or disprovable? And if so, prove that. Many of them still haven't been answered. The ones that have been answered wound up launching whole new kinds of math. Gödel's and completeness theory came from that. Poincaré's torus-shaped universe stuff came from that. Anyway, I bring that up as a spiritual guide to what I'm about to bring up. I've been thinking along the lines of 23 questions for our text, our digital-based life, right? What are, like, can 23 questions be formed and improved over time that are useful, that actually solve like or address specific problems, and maybe possible or may not be? You know, I'll give you a few random examples, and obviously some of the things we've talked about in this call so far would fall right into them. But like a random example might be, I want to be able to write on my computer and have the lines write in much the way that I write in a journal, where I don't have to follow the lines that are prescribed, that I can just, the words can twist around where, however I want, right? That's a problem that I experience. I want to be able to have a spatial control over my digital text. And maybe a caveat would be, but I don't want it to be in Canvas. Okay, so then what's the problem with Canvas? Okay, let's define that and try and flesh that out. And then from that process, come up with a kind of a problem that is sufficiently complete, that says like, this is the interaction I want to have. This is the freedom I want to have. And like a lot of the problems that Hilbert brought up, they weren't applied math problems. They weren't practical, but they wound up being useful later on. Primarily, they were useful saying, hey, here's a different way to think, right? So many of those, right? Like when you just use the word creative in reference to math, that was really interesting, because I was in a different space where I would think that like creating art would be creative and math would be learning formalisms, right? So here we have this problem all of a sudden of this word that with, you know, its meaning is actually more dependent on your view of the world at that moment versus my view of the world at that moment, right? So a problem might be, and this again would be really difficult to, this is the hard part, is to figure out how to way to explain this idea. Is it possible to create words that can maintain the context of the author, you know, while they're using that word, such that that context is transmissible to another person reading it? And then, you know, like one answer for that is, yeah, just read the freaking article or the context around whatever a person said, you know, put more effort into describing what you mean. But is there another way to get at that? And if you can't, does that imply limitations on fundamentally what computers can do around search and recall, right? Like if there are limitations to understanding one's internal nature that requires a certain amount of effort by another party or some other kind of thing, does that mean that this is an inherent limitation in this meta medium that we're dealing with, and that it's kind of like not worth a whole lot of effort to try and solve? Anyway, so yeah, I bring that up as like, it's a prompt and I'd love to get ideas or talk about it more. Like what would 23 questions be like, right? Like they could be as simple as, I want to be able to highlight text, the same text multiple times, right? Or, which seems trivial. That probably doesn't rank as a 23 problem kind of problem, but maybe there's something underneath that that is suggestive that can be brought to the surface, right? Anyway.
Can you name one or two of those 23 problems, please?
Hilbert's or mine?
Hilbert's is the original.
Hilbert's? Yeah. Let's see. Continuum hypothesis. That is about the nature of infinities. Are all infinities the same size, or are there infinities of different size, right? The real famous one is resulted in Gödel's incompleteness theorem, which had to do with essentially, is mathematics logically complete? Is it logically consistent? And he proved that it is not logically consistent. So you can still do a whole lot with math, but at some point it relies on a kind of a human level agreement with what these symbols mean, right? That was a pretty famous one. Let's see. This one, the finiteness of certain systems of functions. Motivation for Hilbert's 14th problem came from previous work he'd done showing algebraic structures are called rings.
I mean, this is a great provocation to try to do the same for text. He did it with numbers. Can we do it as a community for text?
I would love to see that. I think it would be interesting because I feel like it would cast a light on how reliant we are on the engineer's mindset or on formal systems, right? Like, obviously, computers are the result of formal logic. And they are great when they're used for formal logic problems. But the way that we use them today as life augment enhancers, as social tissue, it doesn't fall within the domain of logic necessarily. And so it would be great to present enough bits of evidence to be like, hey, maybe it's time to rethink how we approach the substrate, the unspoken parts of software.
I think this is very, very important. One of the things I did at the Future of Text in California a few years ago was break into groups. And one of the groups was tasked with just writing down and listing different kinds of links or connections. You know, these were really clever Silicon Valley people. And they had no idea. That was scary, right? So can we do that now? Can we talk about the one aspect being the connectedness of text? How many types of connections are there possible? Sorry, here you go, Emily.
Yeah, I think what's interesting about the problem.
Emily's had a haircut. Everyone has to have a look and give her applause.
Hello.
Someone
has hit
my before. Hi.
That's lovely. Hey, Emily.
Some of them. Wait.
I have to go. I'm going to.
Okay, sorry. Sorry about the.
The interesting part of the prompt of framing it as a problem is that it's not as much as like, imagine all the different ways. It's kind of more around like, here is a problem that we experience that you may not even, it may not even be a problem you realize you experience, right? Like, but here is a problem, you know, and then, and not have to be obviously like, here's a solution, but to bring it to the community and ask people to try and solve it, you know?
Yeah, but to even just, you know, go back to these first principles, it is really provocative what you brought up. It's very good. You know, it's so easy for me to have a lot of coffee, wake up early in the morning and write it out myself, but that'll just be my brain. You know, it'll be much more interesting if we try to come together with our very different ways of looking at it. Maybe for instance, one of us wants to write a subsection of, I'm not even going to suggest it, something or other. But to, you know, what is the future of text? The future of text, one of the things it is exploring the limitations and limits to different things of text. And to know the limitations of text, we need to understand the attributes of text. And we kind of go in and out of trying to look at that versus practical things, and then we go into social things. Of course, social things are completely intertwined with text, because text in and of itself, if it doesn't go in a brain, it's not very useful text, right?
Yeah, I think a lot of the 23 problem kind of thing is also very related to what Ted Nelson did. Like, I think a lot of his work could be defined as problems that he's noticed. Anyway, sorry, go ahead, Mark.
No, I was reflecting on what you said. And one of the things that's okay to be sitting about, the more I think about it, is that something we've done quite unintentionally is we've sort of basically tried to computerize print, not text, but yes, text as constrained by the medium print, for very obvious reasons, because it was a technology at the time and it seemed a thing. And I think a lot of the things we're tripping over now prove that actually an unforced error early on was us basically trying to digitize bits of paper. It's not that they're wrong, and I heaven forbid that books go away because I love them, but I just think at a deep level that one of the problem areas is that we perhaps never stop to look at how to what extent our centuries of experience with print, digital print, because if you look back, you know, people have written greatly about how the arrival of print changed the way we wrote. And we haven't perhaps looked at that. We've just, you know, things have moved so fast we haven't had the moment for that reflection. Anyway, passing thought.
I think it's something that I violently, strongly agree with. I hear it often, print. Print is, of course, not the only analog medium. But as Daryl Allen keeps referring to, there is such a thing as writing on paper. You know, the whole manuscript thing is lost, absolutely. And we can even go back to cuneiform, not as a joke, but as in, you know, that was 3D text for crying out loud. You know, it had attributes of, you know, where you choose to write on this little thing. So yes, we should absolutely not throw away the history. The fact that we've been recapitulating the rectangle in digital, yes, but there is more. Sorry, very exciting. I'll shush for a bit. Please go on, Alan, first, please.
This is just a small, quick point, but in line with that, like, another thing I've been thinking about is, or that maybe it's feed into this. I think we as a culture are inspired by science and everything that science has done. And we assume that science is, you know, progress, because here we can see, like, we've learned more about the world. We have a better explanation about the universe. That's awesome. The problem happens, I think, is that we assume that technology is related to science and has the same qualities. So if you have an improvement in technology, it is progress in the same way that coming with a new scientific theory is progress. And so we don't very often reflect or take a therapeutic approach to what we have. It's just always, oh, this new thing we have is obviously progress, the way that, like, you know, akin to evolution. So let's keep building on it. And there isn't quite a discipline for, first off, realizing that technology really has nothing to do with science. Or, I mean, I'm happy to be misinformed, and thinking of it differently, thinking of it as perhaps even closer to ethics, you know, that it's a thing that's just cyclical, or Alan Kay's fashion. Anyway, that's it.
Of course, it has something to do with science. It's built on science, but yeah, really important point. Thank you, Brandel.
I can't remember exactly why I wanted to give this spiel, but I'm pretty sure it's relevant. I teach a lot of people programming, sometimes those people think they already know programming, and so I need to disabuse them of that. One of the sort of interesting exercises is to say, what is the appropriate representation in a program for money? Is it an integer? Is it a floating point value? Because actually those are different, and if you need to have fractions of cents, those are different. But also, like, you can have money represented as a Boolean of just yes or no. Like, does somebody have money or do they not? In the sense of having something like a bank account. But there's also, depending on what you need to do with money in your context, you might actually want to have something like the currency or the condition of the money, if it's actually for money collection, coin swapping, or if it's for float within a cash register. Then you might want to know that you have so many 20-cent pieces versus dollar notes or dollar coins. Something that is objective is still highly subjective, based what somebody has in terms of money. The specific context of it is deeply relevant and wildly divergent depending on those contexts. It's in that same vein that there's not an adequate level of nuance for people to understand things like connections, and you need to go through similar sort of what I tend to do in the answer to that question of, like, how can two things be related to each other, is sort of berate them with a couple of different instances where, like, the representation and the nuances of that representation can be wildly divergent depending on the context. And I think it's instructive in the context of building sort of formalized systems around something. My daughter is waving outside. Because it's really clear that even when you have something as sort of hard-edged and measurable as money, that that you have to sort of work back from what it is you intend to do with it, and there's no such thing as a sort of a context-free appropriate representation, because nobody cares about all of the surface details on your 20-pound note unless you're in the business of swapping those 20-pound notes, in which case it becomes the most important thing in the world. I don't know. Sorry.
that's totally relevant. That reminds me, there's a fantastic book, All Data Are Local, that is in keeping with that theme very much. Honestly, it's like a Martin Luther level point, because it's basically saying the way that we treat data right now is foolish.
I mean, this is where it gets phenomenally interesting, because any word has to refer to other words to have any meaning, obviously. And how much Doug had two types of links, as I'm sure half of you at least know, explicit and implicit. A word is implicitly linked to its entry in the dictionary, for instance. You know, we call that search now or whatever. And then, of course, there are many types of explicit links. And this is where metadata gets very, very interesting, of course, Brendel. And this is something that I want to be able to capture, but I don't want to go down the route of manually adding metadata because it gets expensive and boring. But I think that in rich environments, such as virtual environments, if we choose to package stuff together, you know, this is what I want to have included with this stuff, and just let that bit happen automatically. Like, you know, example, an author you export with a heading, it knows it's a table of contents to be generated. It's free, that kind of stuff. So with the money stuff, it's a really good example. Sorry for rambling. Leon, please take over.
Great. Sorry.
Yeah, very interesting. I was also thinking, when we look through the lens of AI solving problems of humans, then I could also imagine that actually the humans, that it's sort of a human problem that students are going to summarize texts. And to me, it almost feels a bit that we are in a certain culture, a certain sort of a mindset, almost a tunnel vision, where just like Brendel said, like, we don't want to be misunderstood. Like, if we if an economy professor writes a paper about unfair inequality, blah, 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 and a summary would then mention people who have lots of money, this lots of money would immediately trigger all kinds of, you know, this professor who wrote that article would immediately be triggered, like, oh, this is not okay, I don't want to be misunderstood. And I think there is a bit of a difficulty with text really empowers everybody can read it, everybody can, you know, have an AI summarize it, but the writers are sort of easily triggered, or they are, maybe it's also a status thing, they don't want their texts to be simplified or misrepresented. And I think this is a bit of a is also adding to the problem of that, you know, maybe these simple summaries will never be embedded in the papers, because people have a tendency to go for the highest precision in their papers, as if it can be attacked from any moment. So I also see some issues there, that we ourselves are not really ready. You know, every writer doesn't really like to read summaries, because there's a lot to disagree with immediately. So that's just my some thoughts I had.
Yeah, the problem gets really deep really fast. It's pretty wild. I mean, like, sometimes some of the issues that brings up is how to know how much attention to allocate to whatever you're reading, right? There are things that are skimmable And there are things that seem skimmable because the words are simple, but you actually have to read every single word to get a sense of what it means, right? And sometimes you don't know that. Sometimes you don't even have the energy to apply your attention that way. That's a great point. It goes back to some ancient philosophy, right? You never walk in the same river twice. So if printed text, if text committed to some sort of artifact is put down, that's still very much like a river, you know?
So this is really exciting. I talked to someone recently about this. And one of the things he talked about was using the visual meta model, not just for one thing, but just like what Peter has said before, addendums to addendums. So for instance, at the point of generating the downloaded PDF, include several different types of summaries and all of that AI stuff in clear categories. So it can be used like we've talked about, but make it clear when it was done. And then the end user software can choose whether to have this updated periodically or whatever. And when it is, maybe compare how was this analyzed in this year rather than 10 years later with the same technology. So the idea of metadata added either carefully from the source or entirely arbitrarily with AI, as long as you know why or how it was added, it can become a really interesting resource. I mean, one thing that would be really great and that I want more of is the ability to use our own data sets for these things. I would really, really love to take all our years of transcripts into an LLM thing. Say, this is our background. Use the internet if you want, but that's our background. So every time I do a transcript, if there is a noted change of tone, or if the keywords are now used in a different way, tell me. It may get it completely wrong. That's okay. But it's yet another way that we can look at our own stuff, right?
Yeah.
I mean, when I'm talking to you guys, often I go into Lightroom because doing image stuff to me is like playing with Lego or whatever. You know, it's relaxing, but it's useful and it's powerful. Shouldn't we have the same kind of nice tools to play with these type of textual things? Mark and Brendel, fight. See who's first.
Mark's first.
Okay. I was just quickly reflecting. I was just listening to another thing going by and reflecting on the fact that one of the problems with summarization is goes back to this fact of, well, what is the reader doing with this? Am I summarizing this sort of in a sense so I can come back and know that I read it before? Am I looking for an insightful summary of something I don't know about or should know about? And they're all subtly different in the sense that if we set out to do those deliberately in doing a summary, we might structure it slightly differently. So the fact that, you know, we'd have to stop and think about it is useful in terms of before we throw too many brickbats at the poor old software, because we're sort of expecting it to cover all those things unintentionally, but we're sort of expecting it to get the right answer without us almost necessarily signaling. And I don't mean in the pedestrian sense of the prompts we give it, but to really understand quite what we wanted from it when we asked for the summary. I mean, I don't think it's a simple answer for the reason stated, in the sense that it's often highly contextual to what you're doing. Brandel.
This is Galaxy Brain and also very half-baked, so bear with me, but I think it's interesting. And presumably people have thought of it before, but what I realized is the problem with it is, so my daughter is 10, which means that she is exploring some really snarky and uncooperative modes of communication. And I stumbled across a video about Grice's maxims of communication and some of the sort of the various implications that communication tends to follow. Sam Altman was recently kind of surprised by how much hidden context tends to underpin person-to-person communication. It was just like, dude, yes. I'm glad you're here now. I wish you hadn't done quite so much before getting here, but whatever. I think one of the big challenges for me with sort of so-called AI tools at this point is that they are misleading in terms of the epistemic modeling that we have the ability to do about the sort of the boundaries of their experience and the sort of thing that we expect them to do as a consequence of the way they're doing things and the interface they're providing. So when you have an electric drill, you don't have to understand everything about, you know, brushless motors or direct drive or AC or anything like that in order to be able to do it. But there's a consistent epistemic sort of model that you have of what it is that a drill is and what a drill does. And when you have slightly more elaborate tools like Microsoft Excel or numbers is Apple's one. I use it that frequently. you have epistemic models, whether you understand them perfectly or not, of what it is that it's going to do, what you're going to be able to trust. The challenge with ChatGPT transformer models and things like that is are twofold. One is that it's dressed up in the sort of the trappings of what a human agent acts like and looks like. And that's further complicated by the fact that a lot of ChatGPT has been substantially actually written by humans at various times. But the other thing is that it's not a consistent form. So if drills hadn't existed in various forms for literally thousands of years before we electrified them, or if you somehow like were able to live in a society where there hadn't been drills and then suddenly drills came to be, then what it is they can do and very definitely can't do wouldn't be nearly as visible. And so it's really hard to imagine the sort of the appropriate seams and the epistemic modeling of what you think it is that AI can do in a context where, one, it looks so much like exactly a person, and we're tripped up for on both sides of that, where we sort of have expectations that are much higher or much lower. It's like, can you form sentences? Oh my God, that looks amazing. Or it's not quite what I would have summarized this as. Because we don't have a good, it's not presented, it's not packaged in a way that is good for giving us an appropriately sort of boxed context for apprehending the results, for being able to go like, oh, this is this, it exists in this form and I can have these expectations and guarantees and guesses about it. Like you would, a drill that only drills a half circle is most definitely wrong and broken, or a drill that doesn't have the sort of the axis of rotation as dead even is most definitely wrong. But like, what is it that is definitely wrong about an LLM generated result? How do you tell, how can you understand the sort of the characteristics of its operation and working? And part of that is that it's sort of actively trying to dress up like people. But part of it is also that there is not an adequate continuity and consistency of that interface. And that's, you know, that's unfortunately kind of just a function of time, in the same way that, you know, a violin is a violin, not because violins are good, because they're definitely not for people's chins or necks, but because they are violins. And so there's this really, really consistent model for apprehending what it is that a violin is and does and what you need to be able to do with it. To the first question of like, is there a better representation that an LLM can kind of present itself within? I think, yes, probably. That's the magic carpet. That's the other sort of constructions of appropriately intersubjective representations. One of the reasons why I'm upset about, sorry, I'm really going on, aren't I? One of the things I think it's worthwhile.
Please continue.
Well, keep going. Oh, cool. As long as it seems valid. That one of the problems with the current sort of crop of AI is that it resists these intersubjective kind of representations, and we haven't done enough introspection or development of tools that have that as a goal. And we've merely said, if we promise there's valid stuff on the inside and we promise that what we see is valid on the outside, then we can completely ignore any aspect of intersubjectivity. And it, you know, it's not that it's easy. It would be really hard to go like, the fuck do these hidden weights mean? But I think that that's an important kind of component of it, rather than just sort of sticking a stick into the data again and stirring. But the second one is kind of a longer run one, and it's largely a result of the part, is what are the consistent forms that can give us the proper context for the apprehension of a LLM-based workflow? What is the right shape for AI? That means that we can understand what it is, and more perhaps critically, what it isn't. I don't have any answers for either of those two things, but I just came to it and I was really excited to share it with you all.
Yeah, perfect. Leon, continue.
Yeah, I really like these thoughts, Brendel. I also started to think that I don't know if you know this robot Asimo. I think it's a robot from Japan. So, looking through your lens, it almost feels a bit like these LLMs, these ChatGPT. They are sort of looking like a human or talking like a human, and it's like wow, but in the end, it's perhaps a bit of a temporary thing, like this Asimo robot. Like everybody, it's fun to watch. It gives you this wow factor. Like wow, we're living in the future. But it's not like that's what people are using in the last years. We're using very very specialized robot arms in a factory. They're not really human. They are very far from it, and they do a specific task. So I could imagine, for example, Reader to be something which already goes beyond this point, where it's basically more hidden, the AI part. It doesn't act like a person talking to you or typing to you. But so that's the thoughts you triggered in me. Thanks.
Awesome. Yeah. Yeah. And it's not to undermine the legitimacy of Asimo or ChatGPT, but that Asimo is an exercise in going like, well, what is locomotion, and what can we learn about what's similar? I see a lot of that stuff in people talking about fused deposition modeling, 3D printing. They're like, well, all of the things you know about injection molding plastic are to do with heat shrinkage. And so you don't need that anymore. You can build things in these authentically different ways. And it's kind of skeuomorphism, actually. To go, well, we need to recapitulate these structures and these formations, these processes, but we need to use that primarily as a learning exercise to go like, what is this media? What is this material? And what do we need to borrow? And what do we need to throw away? Sorry. Alan, go ahead.
Thank you, Fred. Excellent points, touches on a lot of things that can only be themes. They can't be like they're axioms. They're not really formulas now. But Alexander Obenauer, who's working on a kind of a rethink of the OS, mentioned an idea that I love and matches with this, and screws, not glues, or the value of being able to have parts that you can unscrew and sort of take apart, dismantle, versus the very Apple approach of glue, you know, like put everything together because you get higher gains out of that. I get that. But there's a point at which we have to question optimization, right? There are things that are only possible through incredible precision, specialization, and optimization, like making superconductors. Requires 26 different factories across the world doing very specific things that can't be replicated. But then, you know, that opens us up to certain fragility. And also there are kinds of problems that often get picked out by the Y Combinator crowd of being like, oh, this is a common problem. Let's optimize it. Let's find a solution for it. And you find out that they don't really, the solutions don't take off because the brute force approach has an invisible attribute of freedom of movement, of optionality. By doing the manual version each time, you can change up the rules, you know, and so there's an unspoken trade-off, a discipline or whatever, or procrastination that is part and parcel of any optimization. Wow, that's a lot of nonsense words. Okay.
No, it's not nonsense words. This is really important. This is so important because what happens when you optimize too much? You lose robustness. It's simple, right? One of the things that Chris Gutteridge and Mark and I talked about a lot many years ago was how to connect documents, right? You should have a link and you should have the citation information. You should have the file name. In other words, more. If it's important, just do more. Right? Optimization can lead to serious issues. Yeah, it's very important, Alan. Just look at our supply chains right now, you know, physical, real world ones.
Yeah.
But how does that relate to text? It relates to text. And, you know, we're in this conversation, we're kind of layering all kinds of stuff to see how it works. And then you come along and take the foundations away from that and says, well, you know, what are the foundational issues of text? Look, you know, like with mathematics. I think we should probably have a properly announced discussion on that, send out something to people. We also need to have your paper one, of course. We should definitely try for that. I mean, one of the issues with this community is we hardly ever write anything. You know, can AI help us with that? Now I'm going on the complete opposite side as a use thing for us. How can it help us get stuff down?
One of the funny things, going back to the thought experiment about enterprise LLMs, private, you know, the magic carpet that could be, is and kind of why I'm interested in it is, let's say that it happens. Let's say it's perfect, answers the question perfectly. Well, then you're left with a different problem, which is everyone's still using the same tools that got everyone into that siloed documentation to begin with, right? So if everyone's using, say, Google Docs internally as an org, or Quip or Jira, and then they dump all that information into an LLM and it pops out these great answers, well, then there's nothing in play to there's nothing out there that treats LLM as a first class citizen yet, understandably, because it, you know, it could just be snake oil. But I guess I'm kind of forgetting why I brought that up. But, oh, yeah, writing.
Yeah,
it's the tools that we use to write with are still so, some of the times that's the thing that I have the problem with, right? Like, I'm writing about what's wrong with articles, but I have to write it as an article. Anyway.
Yeah, that's the thing. I now have a library and reader. It's not public yet. It should be any minute now. It's been like that for a week. So I'm trying to solve some of these problems for myself. And as you probably saw, the email I sent around with the idea of how to fold while authoring, you know, this is me capitulating to the fact that this has been a pain in my life. When I write a long document, this, the act of scrolling becomes messy. So that's why we've experimented with before of folding under headings, but it's always been a bit rough. I don't want people to have an extra line spacing or something weird. So the function that I've developed, and it's not implemented yet, is simply select an arbitrary amount of text that you're done with. Do a keyboard shortcut, and it's gone. It's replaced with the first sentence and hard brackets. Basically, it's cut and stored in a safe place. When you click on this hard bracket with the first sentence, it goes back again. So it's kind of like stretch text. But the point is, for us to deal with our own problems, Alan, to write about stuff, when what we're writing about is the fact that writing about it is shit, is of course why I developed Author. And what I'm able to do as an individual is so tiny. But if there is any stuff we can do to help us even experiment, I will try to do it. Whether I can code it or whether we can just experiment with it, because
I'm not for the record, before I when I mention that struggle, it's not like this I'm putting the blame on articles, You know, obviously we have electric drills and they're not hot air balloons for a reason, right? Like, we have these tools, we have to use them. That's on us to
No. I'm just saying
we're not arguing
for our tools, because also if you want to communicate in a different way, like if you want to reinvent the web, why not, right? A poor worker blames his tools. Rubbish. Just think about the one with the electric drill that doesn't have the right bits, right? Mark.
I was just reflecting when you were talking on the thing of sort of LLMs or more contextual ones. I guess they're sort of SLMs, really. Because I'm living through this accidentally and ironically in my support of the Tinderbox community. Because this guy turned up, he said, I've got this cool tool that basically makes me an LLM that I think consists of about 6 PDFs, as far as I can work out, about the application, about which I've probably written more than any other person, apart from, well, probably more than the person who made it. So in other words, his LLM is what I'm writing, and I was interested in asking why he was doing this. He said, "Well, I haven't got time to ask or read. I just want to chat with this thing," and he was complaining it was out of date. Well, and I pointed out to him that, well, you're now engaged in a conversation with the person that wrote what you're looking at through the lens of the past. So why not ask me what the problem is, or indeed, more usefully, explain to me why it is you can't find what you want. Because I totally accept that as being a fair critique of my writing, because that writing is deliberately designed for other people. And if people can't find stuff, then I've unintentionally failed in delivering on that. So it's a really interesting, I mean, it's something I'm still sort of noodling with, and also wondering, you know, how small is an LLM allowed to get before it doesn't deliver? Maybe it can be very small. As small as one document. I don't know. I'm just not my area, but it is interesting. Another thing it shows is we have this compulsion. It's again, I think it falls out of this way that we all overvalue our time massively and undervalue the time of others, the time and thought of others.
Oh yeah.
We don't mean to do it. It's absolutely not a deliberate thing, but I think it's there in us all. And it's something I do try to hang on to that in dealing with things, because often just at the moment when you're about to say something unhelpful to someone, you realize, okay, fine. No, what I need to do is I need to try a bit harder.
But this is so important, Mark, because, you know, like the whole Socrates complaint about text, it's not interactive, it's not the original. You know, I've joked many times about developing a text system called Socratext. You know, it's that interactive. Of course, it would be phenomenal if we could develop a layer of text that accesses the author. You know, one thing I tried to do in a video format a few years ago, and I just didn't have the heart to continue. It was very simple. You sit in front of your computer and you record yourself answering questions, right? So let's say you're a teacher. One of the questions might be, is there a dress code for classes? And you just answer it. And you just, whenever you want to, just keep building up this thing. And people can send you new ones. But the whole idea is that the interface from the other side is like a bot. You ask this thing's questions, and if it doesn't know the answer, it'll try to do an AI thing, obviously. But if it does know the answer, it'll just play back that original video. Right? And that was kind of fun, but it's not really within my remit. But imagine if we could do that with text. Imagine that if you hand in, and now that I'm in really interesting conversation with this person at this triple letter acronym, imagine if you could hand in a paper for an academic conference and also say, by the way, here's more. Not just as a, here's the data, but here's the author's overlay. You know, why can't it not be an official part of it?
Yeah, and it sort of reminds me of recognizing that WordPress is a word processor. And all of these websites and apps that ask you for the, not sure if you're familiar with like Facebook's Open Graph protocol and the OG images and OG text and subscriptions. Because we kind of conclude that that's meta information, but it's actually just information. And like the preparation of a text is the preparation of an artifact for apprehension in a context, and people deciding on a book cover is the same thing as the OG image and the OG text. They're both sort of crushingly mundane as acts, and a lot of people, and at a lot of times, but they're they're deciding what the information is. And one of the things that's really fascinating is recognizing, one, that that's just as contentful as writing the book or authoring the text per se. And two, we should be open-minded about what other sort of dimensions of something are imaginable and sort of externally valid in a context that may be worthwhile for you to consider. So like my mother-in-law is into Morris dancing, and they had a farewell thing because she's going back to New Zealand this week. So somebody had come up with a dance for the Wellerman, because Wellerman is actually from our hometown in Dunedin. And everybody was very excited by that, you know, that song that was all the rage in the pandemic. And it's really like the expressive repertoire of Morris dancing is limited and has limited external legibility to many people. Most people aren't very good at it, and most people aren't very good at reading it. But nevertheless, it's a piece of media, and it's a piece that can be authored and considered and designed and sort of considered along with the sort of the rest of the slate of things, attributes and dimensions that exist for that media. And yeah, like in that same sense as you should have a tool that obliges you to consider the OG image and the OG description, maybe actually being able to kind of trigger all of the Philips Hue light bulbs in an area to be able to say what color the light should be when somebody is reading it. If somebody has a preferred sort of repertoire of scents that should be playing over the olfaction sort of systems in the area, those are all not real today, but could be just as valid as mechanisms. And so, yeah, what the boundaries of a text are, what you mean by sort of composing, arranging, and presenting, and excluding various aspects of the sort of the things that you understood or thought about as a consequence of building them, it's really interesting, really provocative. But we also don't know, and for human agents, but also for non-human agents of the kind that we don't have good enough models for today.
Yes, super important. We are over time. Today, I'm okay going further if you guys are. I think we've gotten onto a really good topic, and I certainly don't want to cut Leon off. Do you guys want to do another 15? If someone has to leave, they have to leave. I mean, Randall, I believe you have a job somewhere in some kind of a fruit orchard or something, but...
Yeah, I've got to drop in a few minutes, but yeah, I'm
okay.
I need to listen rather than just talk and then leave.
All right, Leon, please.
Thanks. Very interesting point, Brendel. At some point I heard something like OG image. Is that correct?
Or did original you say gangster emoji? It's a term of endearment for rappers.
OG is short for Open Graph. It's the Open Graph protocol as defined by Facebook. So when you post a link in Facebook, then you get a picture and a paragraph. Similar thing for Twitter. So it's a sort of a requisite component of a lot of people's media authoring, is to be able to say like, and similar for the keywords, the meta equivalents in the hypertext document of like, this page is like that page, but in this language, was something that Apple went through a whole spate of in order to make sure that non-English search results turned up with the proper priority in those languages and things.
I prefer Alan's definition, but whatever.
Sorry to bring it down.
Yeah, that is very, very useful. I was also thinking about, this might be a bit of a sidestep, but going back to Freud's earlier questions, like, you know, if we have this spatial era in front of us and we have other ways of representing text, I can also imagine that, and I'm going back to the summary, sorry for that, I'm not sorry, but I can imagine the summaries might also indicate that we're overloaded with context, and people overvalue their time because of that, and because of that, they don't want to read too much, and they want to be sure before they read something, you know, what is the summary? So maybe, let's say an XR reader application would be perhaps supporting a PDF format, which always starts with the first page is a summary. So then it would only show that that summary page, and maybe it could be a spec or specification that every sentence on that first page of the summary, if you click on it, it will basically search in the document for exactly that same phrase. Maybe it's a chapter or it's a, but then you can basically go further into detail or, I think this summary could be maybe replacing this whole index, which is usually in books. Like most of the time you have no idea what these words mean, but if it's in context, in a small summary, you might have a much better entry point to, you know, maybe read more or not. So that's just my few cents here.
Okay, I've got a dollar on that, not a cent. Yes, that would be nice. People won't do it. We should develop systems to fake it. Alan.
On that quickly, on the note of indexes and other kinds of indexes, I think that's another worth topic, because I feel like there's a lot of unexplored territory there. Summaries being one option, index being another. What about like a kinesmatic index, an index that showed the joints, how these links are related to one another, like, you know, in reference, these concepts come first to lead to this X thing rather than just jumping to it. Anyway, the main thing I wanted to touch on was going back to Mark's comment and the theme of eroding the firmament that I sometimes do. This is pretty broad what I'm about to say, but I like to think about and would love to talk about trying to identify background truths or beliefs of modern life that we just assume are always that way, and they weren't always that way. And one example might be this feeling of I'm fascinated by the phenomenon of people charging for their newsletters, and that people pay for these newsletters, which is obviously valuable content, but they're paying oftentimes way more than they would for a book by that same author, right? So here's this newsletter that's coming out maybe weekly, maybe monthly, right? But that this seems to be a workable pattern blows my mind. And it must come from some beliefs that we all share, that like time is money and that more content is better, and like just add to the universe with whatever you want to say, right? And when did that start, right? Because like you look at Da Vinci's notes, and he's going through and rewriting his own little passages with no interest in publishing his books or anything. He's just working through the ideas himself. And so I'm not trying to disparage the idea of blogging or newsletters or whatever, but it's wild that we've gotten to that place where it seems like, oh, this is obviously your time is money, so this is how you should spend it. Anyway.
Not just time is money, but, you know, when people want to look at provocative, you know, boobies online without using too much language, there is still a market for people being there live, even though you can get pictures for free. So the whole idea of getting close to the person, even though it's a digital medium, whether it's, oh, this person wrote this today because it's a fresh newsletter, rather than something if they wrote from the market, I think the human intimacy thing is really part of what you're talking about, which is...
Yeah. You know,
Yeah, I think the connectedness, the immediacy of it also sort of feeds into the sense that it's representative of patronage and support as well, in a way where you sort of get to pay less or have to pay less when you feel like it's a degree removed because the book is already done, like kind of thing. What I wanted to say before was that you guys just about made me want to quit my job to go work at another big tech company, because something that was really fascinating is, like, you're talking about libraries, you're talking about sort of owning media and material and being able to kind of integrate indices and glossaries and things like that. And it's just like, well, Apple does have some of that, but who really has it is Amazon. And if you really wanted to sort of tackle the concept of, like, what does it mean for somebody to own a book? What does it mean for somebody to have purchased a book and to have that constitute something that's part of their repertoire of things that are ready to hand. And if you think about somebody having an Amazon Kindle, not that there are alternative ways of owning a book, but Amazon gets to decide what a book is, what owning a book is, and what having information that is sort of relevant within the confines of those books ready to hand. And it strikes me from being a fairly ardent Kindle book purchaser that they have really slept on the ability to think about what it is that you can do with all of the media you have, how you can relate and reflect on it, and the sort of recurring value you can get from it. Because there's so many people who read a lot of books and don't reflect on it, or people who read a lot of books and have to keep some kind of alternative mechanism of note-taking or references in order to be able to get the benefit of it. And it's not that everybody needs to be able to kind of quote chapter and verse of the latest bodice ripper they have, but I think there's a sufficient contingent of people who have, on the one side, an interest in sort of providing artifacts, presenting what it is that a book is in such a way that it retains value for the people who have it. And on the other side, people who have enough wherewithal and interest to be able to kind of cultivate a more spirited, intentional kind of construct of the totality of the books that they have, they've read, they've understood, they've interacted with. That I think that there's a lot to be able to do there. And I'm actually a little bit deflated and devastated that more people haven't kind of seen that. So
let's do it. Let's make a new ebook format. Let's take over. Like there could be so much more. It's such a wild case study. I'll just say this real quick. Okay, go ahead.
No. Alan, of course, finish. Of course, finish.
Well, the ebooks as a history of ebooks is actually something I've been writing about a little bit, like not in the history of ebooks, but that we got into this mess, and ebooks as an alternate timeline of the internet, for better or for worse. You know, like, it's great that we don't get ads inside of ebooks, that's wonderful, but I can't highlight and grab a text from the highlight section. There's a character limit. So there's so much more that could be done in ebook format. It blows my mind. I mean, in some ways it's good that it has lingered on so, because if it were more sophisticated, there would certainly be ways to interject more monetization and awful, you know, reading experiences. But at the same time, I think books themselves could be personal knowledge management accessories. Your mm-hmm. thoughts could be stored and remembered because, you know, Zinnovar motorcycle maintenance, you know, that's related to a whole rant that I did, you know, like there could be a decentralized way of containing our thoughts inside of ebooks that would just be beautiful.
Okay. So of course I agree. And the quick caveat is, ebooks aren't really used, which is bad. Also, I like PDFs because they can be around forever. It's just a thing. But one of the things I've been talking to the acronym people about is, why not put the entire XML of the document in Visual Meta or whatever? I mean, I've told ACM, not that it's a secret who I'm talking to, that, you know, the name Visual Meta, who gives a monkey? If they want to change the name, if they want to change the format, doesn't matter. All I'm really promoting is the idea of making clear what something is. I think that's a bit obvious. So I have absolutely nothing against storing in these dead sheets of paper stuff that is live. Okay, so the whole idea of reading a PDF as an EPUB type thing, completely agree with, right? But there are problems of what's available. And this is where we start with that layering. And this is what we can start doing it. The PDFs that we make in our own community, we can build these augmentations on top. We can do this, right? And we should be able to make it readable in any form. You know, it's a cosmetics issue, but with text, cosmetics is everything. Because, you know, text is what it looks like, literally. So this is a really, really important topic. But considering the vast amount of stuff we have as a community, This is a perfect place to start with this. You know, we talked about concepts, we talked about connections, we talked about all these things. We can experiment more. It doesn't just have to be in Visual Meta. It doesn't just have to be in the software we have access to. You know, Leon is a Linux person. You know, so is Fabienne and so on. So how can we start doing this? One of the things we want to do, of course, is have headset versions of this, or thinking hat versions of this. You know, it takes us 2 hours to really have a discussion and get to what we really want. And it's kind of amazingly interesting. Oh, there was something else. Oh, here's another thing. So reviewing the thing corrections for hypertexts, one of the interesting distinctions between a hypertext of cards, like literally hypercard going from one place to another, is different than if you have a like a document where you have lots of links inside it. Raskin called it card sharks and holy scrollers, right? You could say that a PDF, just a plain normal PDF that has some internal links, is a hypertext document. It just happens to be bound. And we've talked about the notion of binding before as being really, really important. Right now, for our own books, we only have the binding that I choose to make because I'm the editor. That's not enough. Right? If someone should be able to have the front page not be my table of contents, they should be able to choose, based on their AI system or whatever it is, a default view. That's probably the most important thing we can do. How they view the individual sheets is kind of secondary in a way. It's still important, but you know, what is the entry point into this? So
what do you mean, what's the entry point?
Well, the entry point is currently you download future text volume, whatever, you have page 1, 2, 3. You should be able to download Brandel's version, where he's reorganized it completely, highlighted all that stuff. You should be able to download it and view it based on your own, let's say you have a specific set of keywords or key concepts. You should be able to open it up and say, these pages refer to this stuff. So you don't have to wade through it. So it's almost like you have this bound traditional codex underneath, but you're viewing it in an entirely flexible way on top. And I think the most exciting thing that we've discussed today, one of them and most, it goes all the way back to the idea of if you're in a VR space and you're reading something, you should be able to call upon the author, if the author had done this, stand there next to you and point to things and talk about things. We talked about that and it's really exciting. There's no reason we can't do that in a limited way for PDF. One of the functions we have in author is different ways while you're authoring to do highlights and bolds and so on to help the authoring. Vince said it would be interesting if this was exported as a view. So to use the example of Mark earlier, while writing, he should be able to do all kinds of nonsense onto his work. And it's flattened to be read in a normal way. But it's all there in the metadata at the end. So someone can choose to see, you know, Mark's angry scribbles, Mark's highlights, I really mean this, connections to that. And also importantly, things that happen at a conference that's not on the papers, et cetera, and et cetera, and et cetera. Peter.
Yeah, I think we really need to work with standoff markup in that case.
For crying out loud. Continue, I'll fight you after.
Okay. Also, I really like textbooks where some of them will actually have a graph representing all the different chapters and sort of show an alternate flow chart of different ways of going through the book, depending upon what level the reader is coming in at, what kind of a course the book might be being used in, where it's almost like a meta index and table of contents at the front. So you can situate yourself in whichever guided path would be most appropriate, and the author would have maybe 4 or 5 different alternate paths of how to tackle the material in the text.
Okay, I need to respond to both of those. Number one, the first one, standoff, fine. Have as many things standoff as you want, but let's keep the crucial stuff in the document so we don't lose things. As far as the different paths are concerned, anybody today, like Brandel did this amazing VR walkthrough of a book where you could see the different sections in a library. That can be done, or actually in a gallery, and it's wonderful. But in terms of tool making, how do we somehow augment the making of these different levels without it being someone writing a whole different thing many levels? You know, Mark and Peter.
Yeah. I was just going to say that for the standoff markup, that doesn't necessarily mean in a different document. You could have standoff markup as visual meta at the back of the actual document that it's referring to.
Okay, we're friends again.
Yeah, I mean the standoff notion is basically being able to have lots of different things, effectively pointing to the same text without being stuck in the world where you can't have overlapping anchors. So it's something that, in a sense, people like, you know, it's like when you listen to the British Museum when they were describing how they annotate, you know, different versions of the same manuscript. It's sort of, you know, it's been around for a while, the problem, because, you know, it's a very immediate problem in some areas. The reason I set my hand up was just to reflect on the fact that, of course, with a book, it's just the author's narrative on the contents. Now, if it's a story, well, yeah, that's a fairly obvious mapping. The more you move away from something, so the more you move into something like something that's teaching or a scientific or an academic journal or something, I really do think there's a lot of value in seeing the what we think of as the published article just being one of the presentation modes to what the author writes. Yes. I think the challenge that creates for us is that's going to have to, we can't just run on Word, Microsoft Word anymore. It also means that for people writing in that space, they're going to have to skill up in a way that they haven't before. It doesn't mean they won't or can't, but that they have to, that they'll have to learn new things to do it. I mean, I think it's actually a remarkably positive move, and I hope things go in that direction. I'm holding my breath because I suspect I could see all sorts of reasons why people wouldn't want to move to that, but it certainly would make for much richer digital documents.
I think one of the challenges that a richer environment sort of begs for, sort of necessitates, is a better conceptual lens for the authoring environment to imagine the potential context in which the information is going to be apprehended. So we have print preview, and you have overprint previews and things like that in Photoshop. WordPress has sort of has the ability to preview what your OG images and things like that are. If your sort of academic authoring paper thing had the ability to show, like, if you had a persistent artifact that related to how this would turn up as a citation, you would probably think about and craft that as a design object much more explicitly than if you had to sort of do the computation of going like, okay, based on what my paper is now, this is what it's going to look like. And so having the sort of continual representation of what these sort of proposed artifacts and representations are allows you to design for them, to understand what the practical consequences of your creative decisions are with regard to what happens. So, for example, you know, going back to something like the GPT summaries of your 7 hypertexts, you might sort of change or update or add nuance to your text in such a way as a GPT has the ability to do a better job of summarizing those things. And you can sort of interpret that cynically, or you can say, no, Mark Anderson is an author who has a desire for this information to be understood correctly. And so like the ChatGPT summarization stuff is an important part of it. Where I think the intersubjectivity aspect is so challenging is that if you have screwed up your overprint or your gutter margins today, there are very concrete and very hard-edged and simple actions that you can take to say like, oh, I just need to pull this tab in, or, oh, I need to manage the overprint of these different color separations in order to make sure that there's enough of a buffer here, and it's going to alter the line weight that I put on the outside of my figures in order to make sure that the red isn't going to screw up. If ChatGPT screws up the summary of your text and you can anticipate that ahead of time, what does that mean you do? What does that mean for the viability of an ecosystem that supported that is authentically supported by that tool? Because all you know is that ChatGPT didn't really give you a very satisfactory summary. What are the concrete actions that you can take on the basis of understanding that ChatGPT is a necessary component of the ecosystem of work that we engage in today to go like, okay, here, ChatGPT, do a better job, please, other than doing its job for it? I genuinely do not know. And I genuinely do not know from a sort of, again, this ecosystem perspective, what has to happen to all of the moving parts in order for us to be able to get there. But I see it now as an urgently sort of required component of not just the tools, but also the discourse around what AI is. It's just like, well, if I have specific intentions, and it's not just don't use my work, what can I do to make sure that I have the ability to intervene on it, like positively? Do I merely need to lobby ChatGPT to give a better summary here? Or what are the ways in which we actually intervene on this space in order to make sure that it actually does at least some of the things that we want, and ideally as well, maybe doesn't do some of the things that we don't want?
That is a very important consideration. One thing that came up earlier is I wanted to jokingly complain about Mark and Alan. The conversation today, Mark and I had one of those arguments around a thing like we often do. And then later on, Alan came along and just with a big shotgun and shot a hole through things and said, we're not looking deep enough. So what I mentioned kind of a while ago is the idea of when you open a single document or a corpus of documents, how interesting could it be if there are irritations or questions? So it's not actually trying to give you summaries. It's trying to ask you questions about what issues might be or pointing out stuff. Because we have to decide what the heck we want these things for, right? Do we want them to give us answers or help formulate better questions, right?
So quick thought on that. You know, around the 16th century, maybe early 17th, there's this practice in the burgeoning scientific publications of reviewing everything that came before, prior art, right? Mm-hmm. To establish that I know what I'm talking about, the celestial bodies moving around, you know? And that became a convention, and it stuck around for a while. Whether it's good or bad, I think it worked in a time when everybody understood it as a convention, that if you already were an expert in it, you could skip that stuff and jump to the last third of the book where it's actually new stuff, right? So I bring that up to be like, maybe what's needed outside of a technological solution is kind of like what new conventions would be useful, right? Because asking questions is useful in some ways. It's also super annoying perhaps for a reader who feels that they have had their freedom taken away when maybe they just want to scan, right? So would a convention be, here's a scannable, previewable, like Brenda was mentioning, context window of what is following, and to extend it, maybe this is how it matches with what we know about you, with what we think you're interested in, you know? Maybe that becomes like a newer convention for artifacted or published material. And I brought up the history example to be like, that's just one kind. History just wound up adopting that. Maybe it's time for new ones. Anyway.
And there you do another shotgun. This is what I really, I'm very, very, very grateful for today, specifically grateful for today, because we've started questioning our assumptions. And that is obviously what this is about. So I can imagine one implementation, just to make it really simplified, what we talked about is imagine a library where you put in your whatevers, I'm not going to mention format, and you can specify what you want to do. I want to learn stuff easily. That's one level. You know, then you have specific prompts to deal with the documents, but you should also have a different one, like we just talked about. It's like, what's wrong with this? So then we start having a co-pilot, and we also start addressing the issue of different levels of interrogation, right? There's nothing wrong with an AI where you choose to say, present this as a summary in simple language, if it's outside of your field and you want a cursory thing. Nothing wrong with that. But equally, there's nothing wrong with having some seriously deep probing questions for something that you really want to question, right? I mean, imagine a prompt that is there a PhD thesis in questioning the premise of this paper?
The answer had better be, yeah. Seems like there's almost always, that answer would almost always be yes.
but then imagine if we managed to build a knowledge space together. One thing that I found really shockingly brilliant with this PDF Pals was when I took one of our journals and put it in, because we got a ton of transcripts, and I said, what has Adam Wern said? It told me really good summaries of Adam's main points, as far as I remember them. Not necessarily perfect, but imagine if we had a way to feed our LLMs that we've talked about a lot here in such a way that maybe it is these transcripts, whatever. So when you read a corpus, maybe the AI could take a stab at, you know, what would Alan have to say about this? It may be completely wrong, but it may help a provocation to think, right?
Yeah, I think it's interesting. It also made me think, well, isn't this a bit like p-hacking your data? Not intentionally. So that I think it's a really nice idea. This question, well, how do I train the LLM? But that itself questions the whole notion of making LLMs, because the idea is, well, you make the model and it does all the work from there on in. But I certainly think there is, I think that the lesson I take from the current state of the art is there is definitely a need for effectively a teacher's hand on the rudder to sort of basically say, okay, well, that was a good guess, but you left out the following points, or you need to express it more clearly. Quite how that's done, but given that it's a completely opaque machine inside, I have no idea, but I think it there's a clear need for it.
Yeah, we need a rudder to put a hand on.
Oh, go ahead. Sorry.
Just that we need the rudder to put the hand on.
Yeah. And I swear this will be my last point, but on that, there is even something to a difficult problem. Right now I'm reading Dewey's How to Think, and it's from like 1910, right?
Yes.
And since then, you know, the disciplines, the domains have moved on, things have been disproven or whatever. I even saw a review that was like, you don't need to read this book, you know? I'm so glad I'm reading the book, because his way of thinking, his way of presenting ideas, it doesn't even matter to me whether those ideas are at this point disproven or not. It doesn't matter, because I'm learning a new way of thinking by just being, by spending time with him, right? And so that is another thing that's potentially lost or challenged by a world of increasing optimization. Getting an answer to your question in a prompt doesn't necessarily help you learn how this other person thought.
But then we have to look at how deep we want people to look at this. And this is, you know, really important. The kind of questions we're asking here is not really useful in everyday thinking, but it is really, really important for someone who's doing an important job trying to get the bottom of things.
Yes.
Of course, what we need and what we're willing to do is two separate things. That's half the problem. You know, we want the answer because our time is important. And clearly the only reason we don't know it is someone is unkindly not giving us the answer, when in fact the reality is very often, you know, it's more nuanced, and indeed the answer to the question might take several loops through the subject.
There are degrees to which the formalism and the structure of the way in which an answer is understood to be constituted and presented can help pull people toward or away from certain complexities. And, you know, one of the things that I think I've described it here before, that I've played with in the past is, so, you know, when you're building a web page, as I built Apple.com for a number of years, You need to look at it on mobile phones. You need to look at it on iPads. And various people come up with saying, like, okay, well, these are the dimensions that it will be at. And other people go further and say, these are the dimensions, and this is the shape of the phone that somebody is going to be looking at. So if you open up Xcode and Simulator, then you'll actually have the actual shape of the phone, the device, and it's kind of photorealistically rendered. It's better, and many people will not sort of enunciate the reasons for which it is better, to look at it on a real device, to have it held in the hand at the size and the distance that people tend to do. What would be better still, and nobody does this, and understandably so, is go and test it standing on a train. You know, go and walk along the street while using the website, because that is actually where people are. And it makes me think about print preview, like I was saying before, and something that I've talked about sort of jokingly with the people who literally work on mail in the past, is what would a preview of the recipient preview of a document look like, where you sort of you build a sort of a construction of what it looks like if they get this email on their phone, not just what does it look like on their phone, but what does it look like as they get the email on their phone, having somebody sort of scroll through it and look at it and read out loud or possibly kind of murmur some of the statements in it. What does it look like if they're sitting at a desk? What does it look like if they were in the middle of a discussion with somebody else and they received that email? And all of those sort of recipient contexts, those situations in which they apprehend that information are very different, and the meaning that they'll get from it is very different, and the sort of the obligatory sort of work you do as a consequence of anticipating and expecting those contexts would probably be pretty different. And I think that we don't have we have a false consensus around what it is that the information is and what sort of context in which people come across it. And we can probably sort of tailor and pitch formalisms around reminding people of some of those things in order to make sure that they understand that what they're making is not necessarily what they think they're making. You know, people say that 60% to 70% of cold emails are misunderstood and misconstrued. And to me, what that means is that there is not the information that people think. I mean, by definition, what it means is that the information that people think is in the email is not in the email. But the answer is to sort of try to rehydrate and think about what it is they're communicating and attempt to communicate with or through something slightly different. And I think that tools can help us do that, as long as they're sort of presented in the right way to go, like, okay, so here's what it is, and kind of coach people through it. And I agree that some of those things can be pretty repetitive, pretty stupid. A lot of people have kind of say they have a little me running in their heads, and it improves their work because they have the ability to think about the repetitive things that I would ask them about their work in order to think about whether their work is being done correctly.
Excellent.
And, you know, I definitely wouldn't mind outsourcing that. And I think that an AI would be able to do a bang up job of just asking that, like, maybe I don't do it here, but I'm very repetitive as a human being. AI can take that. That'll be fine.
I was literally just writing about this morning in the way that monks would, you know, whatever themselves. I was working on my about page for my website, right? Which I will never publish probably because I can't answer the question about. But I was this time going on about how odd is it that we have this thing called about pages? Like, how weird is that, right? Like, it's now a convention, but the very thing that you want from me is an X on a map, right, of meekness. And the very thing I want from you, this author, this user that I've never met, is what do you want to know? You know, like, what is your X and your map? And I don't have that. And so we fall into these rituals and these performances of like, well, I've gone to this school and I've done that, right? And that, because that's all we have. It's hilarious. It's such a simple seeming problem, but.
Yeah, okay, we need to wind down, but So I think what we're talking about now is applying context on reception, which is really, really an interesting thing. It's not that long ago I got an email from Alan that I thought he was really pissed off. That's how I read it, and we had a chat, and you know, he wasn't. But it's such a great example. Someone I talk to frequently, and you know, he didn't say anything bad. It was my overinterpretation. You know, with the Apple Watch, it does different kinds of pings now. But I did hope it would develop a language where when you get a message, if the answer is yes or no, it would do very distinct pings. You know, imagine if you're doing a presentation, if you get like a specific tap, you know someone is telling you no, you don't need to look at the damn thing.
Yeah.
That kind of stuff from where you are and when you're receiving it is very, very important. And that creates fun things. I think it cuts through a lot of our stuff. I'm now with my thinking cap. I want to look deep into this issue. It's entirely different from I'm a teacher running to class. I've got my GPT thing. Just please remind me what this concept is.
Yeah, that's awesome. One if by land, two by sea. That would be awesome.
I didn't know that well before Edgar just walked in. Can you please repeat?
One if by land, two by sea.
Oh, yes. Yes, exactly.
But that thing of the unambiguous signaling made my mind fly to a favorite movie, Galaxy Quest, and line about with this, you know, I made the cut the signal gesture. I said, no, you made the we're all dead signal. And of course, you know, it's hard to describe. I mean, I really like the idea. I'm sure that will keep some engineers up late to try and figure out how you do that.
My wife just hit the skids when we were running. She went palms first into the ground because she'd set up like intervals on her watch for running and stopping and running, but her watch was muted and she didn't realize that. She was just trying to fudge with it to unmute it and topped over. So like that's a whole other phenomenon that happens where you know affordances a wealth of affordances introduces whole new things you would have taken for granted, you never would have fallen. It happens when we're distracted by this stuff. Anyway, I gotta go.
Just one second, really quickly. Edgar just came in, just mumbled in my ear. I was watching Harry Potter on my own. It wasn't scary. Reason it's relevant is some of the more adult movies, he's watched Iron Man and Harry Potter and a few things. We watch with a little bit of ambient lighting and we watch maybe 20 minutes. We do, you know, next day we watch another 20 minutes. Turning the lights off, watching the whole thing, two entirely different experiences, of course, right?
Huh.
I think that very much feeds into this. How immersed do we want to get?
Wow.
It's not always good to get too immersed.
Yeah. That's a good note.
And Brandel, I'm still very unsure whether I'm able to make it to California for Vince, but he's trying to find some OpenDoc people for me to talk to, so we'll see. Anyway, thank you guys for today. We've gone way over, and it was particularly useful. I really hope on Monday I can be there. I'll warn you ahead of time, but we're going to be in Malta for a few days and then Sicily and taking the train to Rome to see Mark Anderson. So that's the plan. So I'll do as best as I can. Sorry, Brandel, you were saying something when I was mumbling.
No, this has been really, really productive for sharpening my hostility to a much more particular point. I like it, to a constructive point as well. I think it's rather than just like, yeah, so thanks. I really appreciate the work.
Yeah, no, I think it is exactly what we're doing. We're learning more to emphasize what we want and that we're better understanding what the issues are. Greatly appreciate it. Have a good week, everyone. Take good care.
Have a great week.
Bye.
Bye-bye.